Did you know that the classical Limberg flap is not a rhomboid flap? Who actually was Limberg? Watch the video till the end to know the answers. Hi, I am Dev from PlaRecon. Let's begin by defining the Limberg flap. Limberg flap is a geometric, which is rhombic, transposition flap in which the skin laxity adjacent to the defect is utilized to close the donor site primarily. Let's look into it in detail. So a transposition flap in turn can be defined as a local flap consisting of skin and subcutaneous tissue which is lifted, rotated over intact skin and placed over a non-contiguous defect. We also know that in a classical transposition flap, the donor site has to be covered by a skin graft. But the Limberg flap, like the pilop flap or the flaps in Z-plasties, are specialized transposition flaps which make use of their geometric shape and design. So let's move on to the biogeometry of the Limberg flap. So here, the defect as well as the flap are essentially rhombic in shape, that is, a rhombus. A rhombus is a parallelogram in which all the sides are equal, the opposite angles are equal, and the short and long diagonals bisect each other at 90 degrees. So essentially a square is a rhombus with 90 degree angles, but a rhombus is not a square. The classical Limberg flap is moreover a 60 degree rhombus, which means the two opposite acute angles are 60 degree each. So the remaining two angles are 120 degrees each. This gives the rhombus an additional property, which is the sides are now also equal to the short diagonal. So it's essentially two equilateral triangles attached at the short diagonal. Additionally, an incircle can be drawn inside every rhombus, touching each side tangentially and with its center at the junction of the two diagonals of the rhombus. In case of a 60 degree rhombus, the radius of the circle is 1/4 that of the long diagonal. If you wish to know how we calculated these values and what's the use of the same, do subscribe to this channel for further videos. Now we know something about transposition flap and a 60 degree rhombus. So let's see how the geometry has been utilized to design a Limberg flap. Here ABCD is a rhombic or rhombus shaped defect which will be covered by CBEF or the Limberg flap, which is also rhombic in shape. To draw the rhombic flap, extend the short diagonal DB on one side for a length BE which is equal to the short diagonal or any side of the rhombus. Thereafter, from the point E, another line EF is drawn which is parallel and equal in length to one of the sides of the rhombus. In this case, it's BC. Now, the rhombic flap CBEF is raised or lifted in the subcutaneous plane. Its blood supply is mainly through subdermal plexus through its base CF. Hence, the side CF of the rhombic flap should never be marked to avoid incision. The flap CBEF, like any other transposition flap, has F as the pivot point around which the flap rotates onto the defect on the left, in turn leaving a donor side defect of the same rhombic shape. However, what's special here is that the pivot point F moves. It advances towards B. This serves two purposes. Firstly, along with the rotation component, this movement additionally provides advancement to the flap towards A. And secondly, as the flap transposes and the pivot point F moves towards B, the flap donor side gets closed primarily, leaving behind the suture line FE'. On the right, we can see the final suture line after flap inset. This final suture line can be easily drawn by erasing the two parallel lines drawn to represent the two opposite sides of the flap. Note that while transposing the flap, the first suture is taken to approximate the point F and B' such that the donor side closes primarily and the flap lies exactly over the defect. The next suture is taken at the apex of the flap, now at A, thus fixing the flap in position while the other intervening sutures can be taken. We often see that the final suture line B'E' is represented as an oblique line. That's because as the pivot point F moves towards B, it also pulls the point B towards F slightly. And also, the suture line AB dash and the apex of the flap is pulled towards F. So the maximum tension on the suture line is at the point FB dash and the maximum pull on the flap is at the apex, which is at point E or A. Similar to the flap 1 demonstrated above, on the right inferior aspect of the short diagonal of the rhombus, there can be another flap superiorly and another two flaps on the opposite left side of the short diagonal. That means 4 rhombic or Limberg flaps can be designed for every rhombic defect. Now, how do we decide which one of these 4 flap options will we choose to cover this defect? Let's revisit the definition of Limberg's flap and try to find an answer. So, the Limberg flap is a geometric or rhombic transposition flap in which the skin laxity adjacent to the defect is utilized to close the donor site primarily. To figure out which part of the skin is lax scientifically, we need to know 2 lines. The first one is RSTL, which stands for Relaxed Skin Tension Lines. It was first described by Borges. He obtained the lines throughout the body by pinching the skin in the living and noting the direction of the ridges and furrows. The second set of lines, called LME or Lines of Maximal Extensibility, are imaginary lines drawn perpendicular to the RSTL. Hence, it is along the LMEs that the skin is maximally pinchable or lax. So, in the Limberg's flap design, the points F and B, which on approximation causes the maximum suture line tension, should ideally lie along the lines of maximum extensibility or the LME. Here's how we can do that. Let's imagine that this is a lesion on the face, maybe a BCC. Now, I'll draw the margin of excision in a circular fashion around the lesion. This circle serves as an incircle around which we can draw the rhombus. Alternatively, we can directly mark a rhombic shaped margin of excision. Note that two parallel sides of the rhombus should lie parallel to the LME. Next, we can draw the 4 flap options on either side of the short diagonal of the rhombic defect. Please note the line F and B and its equivalent along which the primary closure of the donor site defect happens lies parallel to the line of maximum extensibility in only 2 of the 4 flap options around the rhombic defect. In case the quadrant or position of the other 2 flap options is more favorable, we may flip horizontally the rhombic defect orientation to achieve the same. Now, let's look into the advantages of Limberg flap. It's a very versatile flap for small and medium-sized defects, especially on the face, where using skin laxity and geometry, the donor site just closes primarily like magic. It gives rise to aesthetically superior reconstruction. However, it does have some disadvantages. In younger patients with tight, firm skin or larger defects requiring a large flap, if the flap is not planned properly and the line of donor site closure is not parallel to the LME, the donor site may not close primarily or it may close under great tension, leading to problems like widened scar. Also, since in Limberg's flap, a larger rotation of 60 degrees is required, there will be a kind of bunching up of tissue causing dog ear at the base of the flap and also where the flap donor site is closing primarily. The third problem arises due to the closed nature of the final suture line after inset, which is the 3 sides of the rhombus. So it gives rise to a trapdoor effect or pincushion appearance due to the contracture of the suture line scar. Finally, we may have to sacrifice some portions of normal skin to give the defect the rhombic shape. Moving on to some of the clinical uses of Limberg's flap. By now we are well aware it's very useful in facial defects. Local flaps are always preferred on face since no other tissue can really replace facial skin better, especially in the temple region of the forehead and the cheek region with lax tissues. It's also typically used for small defects in the sacral region after pilonidal sinus excision and also in the midline back. Let's quickly see some of the variations in the Limberg flap design. To achieve primary donor site closure in larger defects using Limberg's flap, 2 flap variants for rhomboid shaped defects and 3 flap variants for large circular defects were described by Lister and Gibson, while for a large rhombic defect, Turan described a 4 flap variant. Now let's check out some of the more popular variations or modifications. The first is a Dufourmentel flap. In this modification, the defect still remains rhombic, but the flap is not. Unlike Limberg's flap, here the smaller angle of the rhombic defect is more than 60 degrees, while the angle of the flap is less than the smaller angle of the rhombic defect. Also, the size of the rhombic defect and that of the flap remain equal like the Limberg flap, but they are not equal to the short diagonal. The final modification was the angle at which the flap is oriented in relation to the defect. The side of the flap marked from the defect, unlike Limberg's flap, is not along the short diagonal but is at an angle which is 1/4 that of the greater angle of the rhombic defect. This essentially means that the Dufourmentel flap is narrower and it has to rotate a smaller degree of angle to reach the defect. We commonly get the spelling of Dufourmentel wrong. It begins with du with a u and not a e. Then comes the number 4, followed by mental, where only vowel used is e, not a. Let's now move on to the next modification, which was by Webster. So, in Limberg's flap, there are two points along which rotation of tissue happens. One is at the base of the flap at C, and the other one is at E, where the primary closure of donor defect happens. Webster modified the angles at both these points from 60 degree to 30 degree, so that dog ear formation is least and there is balance of tension around the flap. However, by decreasing the defect angle at the base of the flap, the length of the defect and the final suture line increased substantially. Hence, he came up with the third modification, which was 30 degree emplasty of the defect angle at the base of the flap to decrease the final suture line length. The final modification or variation of Limberg's flap that we'll learn today was by Quaba and Sommerland. They, instead of turning a circular defect into an outer rhombic defect, used a smaller rhombic flap which was 2/3 the diameter of the circle and used it to cover the circular defect, which they described as pegging a square into a round hole. By doing so, they prevented the loss of extra tissue to get the bigger rhombic defect and also prevented the need for a larger rhombic flap. Moreover, this flap could be planned at any direction around the circular defect, and hence the flap side primary closure suture line could be oriented in any favorable direction easily. As you can see, these three modifications answer most of the disadvantages of Limberg's flap. However, each of them have their own disadvantages, which we'll discuss in the subsequent video. You'll eventually find the link to the video above and in the description below. Also, do subscribe to stay tuned. Okay, now let's see why Limberg's flap is not a rhomboid flap, though it is frequently and wrongly called so. Both are parallelograms with opposite equal sides. Unlike rhombus, the adjacent sides of a rhomboid are not equal, and hence the diagonals don't meet at 90 degrees. On the right, we can see a equivalent 60 degree rhomboid defect, and we can easily make out it's not equivalent to a rhombic defect requiring a rhombic flap. Finally, who was Limberg? Professor Alexander Alexandrovich Limberg was a Russian professor of dentistry and a maxillofacial surgeon. He first described the rhombic flap in 1945 in Russian language and in English in 1966. So, did you learn anything new about Limberg's flap? Do let me know in the comment section below. And don't forget to subscribe to this channel for more such tutorials and learning plastic surgery together.